When we talk of the oneness of concentration, it means several things. First, you want a unity in your will, that you really do want to stay here, focused on one object. Which means that you've got to bring all your contrary intentions under control. And we have the phrase in Thailand, it's like catching crabs and putting them in a basket. You've got one crab in the basket, and as you catch the next crab, the first crab crawls out. So you've got to catch the first crab and the second crab and the third crab and keep them in there. And one of the reasons we're trying to make the object of concentration comfortable is so that the mind is more and more inclined to stay here. It's easier to get everybody on board. So that's one level of oneness, oneness of the will. And as you settle down, there's the oneness of the object, which means both that you've got one thing you're focused on and that it fills the range of your awareness. When you're focused on the breath, you want to think of all the sensations in the body as being related to the breath one way or another. In any places where what you had originally interpreted, say, as a sensation of a bone or some other hard part of the body, when you think of it as breath, that changes your sense of whether it's okay or not. Does that feel like a good breath? It felt like an okay bone or an okay organ of one kind, but does it feel like a good breath? If not, okay, work with it. It gives you something to do. And as you go through the body like this, you get to the point where you can perceive all the sensations in the body as having a breath aspect. So it's all part of your one concentration. And this is where the concentration moves from simple oneness of preoccupation to unification of awareness, where the awareness and the breath seem to be one. That can take you quite far. In fact, the oneness of the mind, you may have to change things as you go from breath to space and then awareness. But there's that sense that the object and the awareness are one and the same thing. That's how you get into the state of infinite consciousness. There's a oneness that holds you there. And the perception of the body begins to become a burden. The perception of even space begins to be a burden. You just want to be with knowing, knowing, knowing. And as the Buddha said, that's the ultimate non-dual state. But it's fabricated. We're not doing this to get you there and just leave you there. We're getting the mind ready to do something else, which is to let things fall apart in a natural way. Now, part of this simply comes from the fact that as you're working with the mind and getting it to settle down, you begin to see things, events, activities in the mind clearly that you couldn't see clearly before. You can see the role that perception plays. You hold one perception in mind with the breath, and the breath will be one way. You hold another perception, it'll be another way. You begin to ferret out what the Buddha called aggregates. We actually call them khandhas, we call them aggregates. But these activities of the mind, you begin to see, are distinct things. And John Lee's image is useful here. He talks about heating a rock. When it gets to one temperature, one metal will flow out. When it gets to another temperature, another metal will flow out, depending on the melting point of those metals. And the same with the mind. You're with the breath. Heavy breathing goes away. There's a more refined breathing. The movement of the in and out breath, that goes away after a while. And then even the perception that you've got a body sitting here that has a particular shape, that begins to blur and dissolve. You can start focusing on the perception of space. And there's awareness, the awareness of the space. When you read the translations of the Ajahns, sometimes you have them talking about the one who knows. It's a very literal translation of a phrase basically that means the knower, or just awareness itself. And there's a sense that it begins to separate out. It's like a sauce that's separated. The knower is one thing, the breath is something else, space is something else. When you get the knowing just on its own, and then you return to other objects, you begin to see clearly that these are distinct things. And this is where insight begins. We do this, one, to get the mind still so you can see things clearly, and two, so you can have some hands-on experience with what these different activities of the mind are. So instead of trying to divide things up in line with preconceived notions, you read the ajahns, you read the Dharma and the canon. Well, this must be that, and that must be this. That's not necessarily the case. You might be misunderstanding the terms or misapplying the terms, which is why I've got to get really good at concentration so they begin to see, oh, this is exactly what perception is. When the Buddha is using the word sanya, this is what he means. When he's using sankhara, this is what he means. Fabrication. The feeling, the perception. The sense of the body being the elements. And John Mahabhu has some really good passages where he talks about how, so you're dealing with a feeling of pain. You want to be able to divide out, okay, which part is the body and which part is the pain and which part is the awareness? What's the perception that's making the connection? You want to see these things as distinct events. The concentration allows you to do that again because you got the stillness. You're not trying to juggle all kinds of things all at once. And you've had some experience. So this is what a perception is. This is what it does. You've been using this to get the mind into concentration. You've been using the perception of the body as being composed of elements or properties. So you can settle down and work with the breath. That gives you some hands-on experience. Go, what is it to have a feeling, and what is it to have an energy flow? And how are they different? In the beginning, they're glommed together, but as you work with them, they begin to separate out. This is, as the Buddha said, this is how you begin to give rise to clearer knowing, by seeing these things as something separate. So oneness has its role in the practice, but it's part of the path. And there are times you have to be really careful, because it's so easy to take a perception of oneness, say, as when you're settled down with the breath, or settled down with just a sense of awareness itself, and mistake the perception for something that's there, apart from the perception, prior to the perception. I.e., you start making metaphysical assumptions out there. All things are one, the mind and the body are one, you and the world around you are one. When you start doing that, then you make it impossible for you to see things, to see where the clinging is glomming things together. Now you can let go. So we use oneness as a tool. But we have to realize it has its dangers. It's like having a knife. If you don't hold it properly, it can cut. Cut you. Cut things you don't want to cut. You have to learn how to hold it properly. Image the Buddha gives of the Dharma as being like a water snake. You're trying to catch it. You want something from the snake. Perhaps you want the venom so you can make an antidote. You grasp it by the tail, it'll turn around and bite you. If you take a forked stick and pin it down right at the neck, then no matter how much it coils around you, it's not going to harm you. We don't usually think of the Dharma as something coiling around us with a potential of harming us, but it's there. There are lots of mistakes we can make in interpreting the Dharma on our own. This is why the Buddha didn't just teach the Dharma and just kind of leave it as books out there in the world. He created a community where people can learn through an apprenticeship. So you can get a sense of what it means to grasp the Dharma correctly. How to hold on to it until you've got the lessons you need, and then you can let it go. So oneness is like a snake. It's got its dangers, but it's got its uses as well. So learn how to grasp the concept well. Do your best to get the mind into the state of concentration. Have a sense of the oneness. It's nourishing. It's restful. It helps a lot of things come together that have been scattered and torn apart. And learn how to use it well. This is the middleness of the middle way, or one aspect of the middleness of the middle way. We use pleasure, we use pain. We don't approach them as ends in and of themselves. They're things that we develop. We develop the pleasure of concentration. We learn how to use it. We find that there are certain pains that are useful as well, as we learn how to understand them. But they're tools. So use them carefully. The Dharma is a tool. Use it carefully, too.